Hi YouTube, Michigan Snow Pony Renee. Now why is my bench pulled over and all wonky? Because it's actually blocking a gap under the little wooden fence section where him and his sister over there like to get out, and then they run all over the barn and create all kinds of problems. So I'm blocking it off. And why do I bring that up? Because I want to talk about fencing today and keeping animals contained. You know, there's a lot of different kinds of fencing nowadays. When we were putting up ours 27 years ago, there wasn't that many options, but now there's all kinds of it. So, you know, besides wood and electric fence and woven field fence, I mean, there's PVC options now, movable electric nets, all kinds of stock panel variations, and probably a lot more that I don't even know about. But it all gets a bit overwhelming when you start trying to figure out what you need and what you should go with. Budget's going to factor in, of course, but like all long-term infrastructure things on your farm, fencing is something you absolutely do not want to skimp on. Sorry about the dark lighting there. Your fencing serves a very important function, and that's keeping your livestock where they belong. I mean, at the very least, loose livestock, you know, runs amok in your barn like these little guys. But at worst, you might lose your animals or be facing a lawsuit or both. You know, more on that later. So spending a little bit more and doing it right initially, it's well worth the cost and the effort. And that's what I want to talk about today. Fencing options to keep livestock safely corralled on your homestead. I'm going to be putting together a slideshow to help illustrate what I'm talking about. And I'm going to be including some of the fencing we use. And hopefully this video will help you decide what the best fencing is for your farm and your animals. Okay, let's get to it. Away from these noisy critters. I've got rabbits thumping and goats talking. Okay, let's get down to business here. So, where do you begin on the fencing dilemma? Well, first and foremost, this is kind of obvious, you're going to have to consider the type of livestock. And then you need to think about what ages or age the animals you'll be penning up are, as well as their gender or genders, as the case may be. You know, the way you need to corral intact male animals is often not the same as the females within the same species. For example, in some states, there are laws regarding how bulls have to be fenced in. Usually it's behind a 6-foot barrier. But don't think the ladies can't be just as bad as the boys when it comes to hormones. I have a friend who breeds dairy goats, and she made arrangements to have her does covered by this fabulous, expensive buck, and pulled all her strings, got all her ducks in a row, and was anxiously waiting for her girls to come into heat. And they did, and promptly broke down their fencing to get in with her bucks. And one of which was related to all of them. So, just keep that in mind, that the girls can be just as bad as the boys. So besides age and gender, take into consideration the animal's habits. For example, are they inclined to be climbers or jumpers? Do they like to stand on stuff? I've just described goats right there. Do they tend to burrow or root under things? Pigs, sometimes sheep. Does their size and bulk make them potential bulldozers when they want to be? Horses and cows. Do they often lean, rub, or want to scratch on solid objects in their pen? And that would be all of the above. You know, thinking about these kinds of things will help you determine which type of or types of fencing are going to stand up the best to the abuse the animals heap on it. A second consideration is how big of an area needs to be fenced. Generally speaking, the smaller the pen, the better the fencing has to be, depending on stocking rate. That is, while 3 animals in a 1,000 square foot enclosure aren't likely to be much of a stress on a fence, 40 would be. In other words, the less room animals have to move around, the more likely they're going to make contact in some way, shape, or form with the fencing around them. Now, you may be saying, well, that's not going to be a problem in our place because we have acres and acres for them to roam. But there are times when you will need to confine your livestock to a smaller area, you know, such as what would happen in the case of a holding or catch pen when you want to worm or inoculate or shear or, you know, shear sheep, or wean or castrate, dehorn, or perform other procedures on a group of animals. Or maybe you want to cut out and get sale animals separated and to put on a livestock trailer. So while one fencing type might be great most of the time, you may need a completely different type for those crowded special occasions. Next, consider the lay of the land. Now, some fencing lends itself to difficult terrain better than others, and that's, of course, going to depend on the terrain. You may find you simply have to go with what you can put up and keep up maintenance-wise. Okay, another factor is budget. And as I mentioned before at the beginning of this video, don't be cheap on fencing. It's better to save up and have really good fencing, even if you have to do your fencing in stages. Slow and steady wins the race. Poor fencing and loose animals can lead to all kinds of problems and have downright devastating consequences. If you have close neighbors, you don't want your animals eating their gardens or leaving hoof print potholes all over their lawn. If you're on a busy road, you don't want your livestock creating a traffic hazard. Even if you're out in the middle of nowhere, having livestock lost in remote wild areas where they might not find food or water, or they get injured, or they're attacked by predators, that isn't such a great thing either. So go with the best fencing for your purposes and your animals as you can, and just put it up as you can afford to, if necessary. Now, what about temporary versus permanent fencing? That's something else to consider. Are you going to be moving fences regularly, as with rotational or mob grazing? Or will you be moving animals through permanent pastures? Maybe you'll be doing both, with a permanent perimeter fence and movable interior fence lines. Both are going to require different kinds of fencing. And that brings me to the concept of multiple layers of containment. Now, what that means is several varying types of fence lines around your animals. Now, why would you do this? Well, it's a backup plan of sorts, with the idea being if the animals escape their enclosure, the second or third level of fencing will hold them, or at least slow them down from escaping your property entirely until you have time to discover and remedy the situation. And an example of this is what I do here with my pig pens. My pigs are actually behind several layers of fencing. Now first, as you can see in this picture, is an electrified tape, and that's about snout level. And then there's the hog panels, which provide a physical barrier type fencing. And around the perimeter of the area to the south, and I know you can't tell east, west, south, north, and so forth, but to the south and to the east is mesh garden fencing. And beyond that to the east, and by the next to the closest neighbor's property, is electrified high tensile. To the west and to the north, both of which is still my property, is the electrified high tensile fencing. So depending on which direction the pigs were to go, they would have between 3 and 4 barriers to go through before they would be completely loose. And if I had horses on a very busy road or highway, you can bet I'd have several layers of fencing between them and that road. So something to think about. Okay, let's talk about the types of fencing out there. When people think of fencing, one of the first things that often comes to mind is traditional old wood fencing. Here's my take on wood fencing. It's beautiful, fussy, and expensive. The only time I'd advocate for wood fencing on a homestead is if you can create your own timber or your own boards and posts off your own timber on your property, and you don't mind frequent repairs and replacement. Even pressure-treated wood needs continuous maintenance with painting and staining about every, 2 to 3 years. And horses like to chew on wood, especially, usually it's out of boredom. But if you have horses behind a board fence, you're likely going to have to treat it with something like Chew Stop or some other product like it, in addition to the semi-annual painting. Also, large animals tend to rub on wood fencing, especially to remove winter hair. This tends to make for loose fence posts and crossboards knocked off. More maintenance. Wood fence posts will last quite a long time, especially in dry, sandy soil, but the longest you're going to be getting out of them is probably 15, maybe 20 years. Now, our ancestors made and used their own wood posts, and they found, I think it was locust and Osage orange, to be especially long-lasting and strong. But most of us don't have that access to those, and so my vote would not be for wood. Now, PVC-coated wood fencing has solved the need for painting or staining, and it's extended the life of the boards greatly. There are also UV inhibitors usually added to extend the plastic's life as well. But this type of fencing is very expensive to put up, and it usually is reserved for highly visible fencing along a road or a driveway on higher end horse farms. But if you have the finances, go for it. An old standby that most people are going to think about and probably end up using is electrified wire fencing. This is probably the most affordable way to fence in large tracts of land. You can use wood fence posts or metal T-posts, which makes it even more economical. It's relatively easy to install as well. Another bonus is multiple animal species can be kept in with electric fencing. Now you want to condition those animals to the electric fence at a young age, and that's often the key to good results, especially when it comes to pigs and goats. Now one caveat here, some species' massive coats will insulate them from feeling the shock. You know, breeds like Highland cattle, wool sheep, and even some shaggy horses in winter, we won't mention any names, have been known to be impervious to shocks delivered by touching a hot wire with anything but their nose. And speaking of noses, one thing to know is the spacing of the wires is very important. And think, I want you to really pay attention here. An animal shocked in front of its eyes, like on its nose, will tend to back up away from the fence. However, an animal shocked behind its eyes will tend to shoot forward and go through the fence. For example, if a goat reaches over the ground wire to eat grass on the proverbial other side of the fence, then pulls its head back and touches the hot wire on its neck, it's likely going to spring forward and go through the fence. And I've had this happen frequently with my daughter's weather, since all my high tensile wire has been spaced to keep horses in, not goats. So if you can, space your wire to accommodate the animals you're putting behind it. Another plus to electric fencing is it can be a very effective deterrent for predators coming in from the other side. In fact, beekeepers living in bear country often run electric fencing around their hives. Electric fencing's downfalls are, however, it does not have good visibility. And if you're turning animals into a freshly fenced-in area or introducing a new herd member, you're going to want to flag your fence with surveyor's tape or something similar so they can see it until they learn where the boundaries are. Also, if you have snowmobilers or dirt bikers or whatever using your property, electric fencing can be deadly. So again, if that happens, flag your fences. You know, if you allow people to do that, or if your kids are doing it, or they bring friends over, you know. Electric fencing must be kept electrified to remain effective. And animals will learn to respect its bite, but many of them also appear to have a sixth sense as to when that fence isn't on, and they'll take full advantage of it, literally leading their field mates astray with them. For that reason, electrified wire is not a good, what they call, barrier-type fencing. That is, if you lose electricity, it will often not keep the animals contained for long, especially if you have one of those smarties in there that knows when it's off. Now, that's something to consider if you're off-grid or you're prone to lose electricity often where you live. Of course, now they have solar and battery fencers, so those are options in that case. Okay, well, speaking of electric fences, besides wire, there's also electrified tapes and ropes out there. And these are nice for their added visibility. They come in various widths from about half an inch, there might even be quarter inch, I'm not sure, up to 2 inches, and they come in white and yellow and sometimes other colors as well, but I'd stick to white or yellow because that's the most visible. You've already seen a picture of the tape we use in our pig pen. And these tapes and ropes used with step-in posts and tapped into an existing electric fence, they're great to divide grazing areas up with larger animals. We do that every spring with our horses. When we first start getting them used to grass, we section off part of the pasture with step-in posts and tape, just so we don't have to chase them all over to call them in, because we're not leaving them out there very long, or as long as they think they should be. Horse folks especially like the tapes because they're less harsh than plain wire, and they tend to not bite into the flesh like thin wire will should a horse tangle with them. And some brands also have a very low breaking threshold, so before too much damage is done, they'll break. And that brings me to the subtopic of which is the lesser evil. Animals getting out unscathed by breakaway fencing versus animals getting caught and hurt by fencing that proves less prone to give. And these are my thoughts, and you probably already guessed from previous statements I've made in this video, but if your animal or animals escape unharmed through your fence because it's designed to break away or give when an animal tests it too much, and then that or those animals go down and run along a dark road at night and they're hit by a car and killed, what good did the breakaway fencing do? But now there's likely a person injured or worse who was driving the car to boot. and a lawsuit filed by the family because livestock owners are liable for any harm or damages their loose animals cause. Did you know that? So for me, I would rather have an injured animal, even if it means euthanasia, that did not escape my property than an unharmed one running loose that could potentially lead to much bigger and worse things. That's just my take. Okay, but on a bright note, one type of horse-friendly fencing that still maintains its strength is the PVC strapping. Well, I call it that fencing. And this fence is designed to stretch before breaking, as in the case of a horse running into it. So it's horse-friendly, but it also tends to keep them in. It doesn't break that easily. Okay, so back to the topic at hand. Let's talk about high tensile wire fencing. And this is what I use. This wire fencing can be electrified or not. Because you're using a more substantial wire, and usually it's 9 gauge, with more tension on the strands, it can have a barrier effect when the wires are placed close together. And in that case, no electricity is needed. It also uses less fence posts than conventional electric fencing, but it has to be installed with 4x4 wooden posts and 6x6 corner posts. And if one wants to use less strands, the high tensile also makes a very good electric fence for large areas. It has several advantages over regular electric fencing. Installed properly, it should last 50 years. Believe it or not, yeah, I said 50 years. It's very low maintenance, and it's virtually indestructible. Our neighbors have it, and I watched one time a tree came down on their fence. They were out there, they cut it off the fence, and the minute that weight got taken off the fence, it sprung right back up, good as new. Couldn't believe it. So if you put it upright, it's not going to come down. The downside is, and if you might guess, the fencer needs to be pretty substantial and therefore usually more expensive than what is needed with regular electric fencing. It takes a bit more expertise and work to install, especially concerning the corner bracing system. And animals will get injured if they're caught in it. I've had 2 injuries over the years with not anything that required an animal to be put down, but still I had it. For that reason, it's not recommended to use high tensile to fence in smaller areas like paddocks or holding pens, and I break that rule. But it shines as a method to fence in the large acreages. And even though the initial cost to put it up is quite a bit higher than electric fencing, because you don't have the maintenance and it's good for 50 years, and I believe that after watching mine for 27, it's worth it. All you have to do to maintain it usually is tighten the little tension rods. There's these little springs on each line of fence, or each fence line, and you just tighten them now and then to keep it nice. And it's easy peasy. Okay, while we're talking about electric fencing, another option, especially for movable fencing, is electrified netting. And this is relatively new on the fencing scene. It wasn't around when we first moved here, but I don't know how long it's been out there, but it's pretty cool. And these are often used for the rotational grazing of sheep and free-ranging chickens. Now, I've never used it. I don't know anybody that does, but I have researched it, and I found a really good website. It's a manufacturer, actually, and they have a lot of information. And I'll put that in the more info box, but it's premieronesupplies.com. So check them out if you're interested in that electrified netting. Now, there's also barbed wire. And all I'm going to say about barbed wire is it was developed in the 1800s for the western states because wood was pretty scarce. And don't use it. Do not use it. I don't care. Don't use it. there's so many more options out there that are so much better. Some of the worst cut up horses I've ever seen have been horses that have danced with barbed wire and not lead anyway. So it's just nasty stuff. Don't use it. Nasty to work with, nasty to maintain. Ugh, you don't want it. Okay, another fencing option is woven wire or field fence. And this is a mesh type fencing that comes on large rolls, and it takes a bit of expertise to install as you want to get it really tight, or as tight as you can. And you can buy field fence for cattle, goats, and sheep, or horses. The difference in the varieties is how tightly the mesh is woven. The gaps are usually about 6 inches for cattle, 4 inches for sheep and goats, and horse woven wire comes in like a V mesh shape rather than squares. And that's to keep the hooves from growing through, as horses have been known to walk down a fence when they want to get to the other side. Field fence is great for large areas where the animals will be distracted eating, such as pastures or with, that type of situation. Or you can add a strand of electric to keep them off of it, as goats tend to want to climb or stand on their fencing, and sheep will try to go under it, especially if it's not tight, and cows and horses like to rub on it. So you might want to combine it with a strand of electric, but it's really good barrier fence. Now, I want you to take note of something. There is a big difference between woven and welded wire. And as you might guess, with woven wire, the strands are twisted at each juncture. With welded wire, there's a thin weld holding the joints where the horizontal wires meet the vertical wires. Therefore, the woven wire is much, much stronger. And in my humble opinion, welded wire is not for animal enclosures. It breaks too easily, and then you have these wire ends poking out ready to impale eyes. And if you think about it, even chicken wire is woven. Anyway, welded wire is best used as garden fencing to keep the rabbits out or to contain your compost piles. You know, people get very tempted to buy the welded wire because it's so much cheaper than the woven. But in the long run, you're better off getting the woven stuff hands down. There's only one case of welded fencing being good. And that brings us to my favorite thing in the whole world, stock panels. If you don't know what stock panels are, oh my gosh, where have you been? These are heavy-duty 16-foot by 48 to 52-inch high sections of metal rods. You can't really call them wire, but metal rods welded together that one attaches to metal T-posts. They're also great for a lot of other uses and projects on the homestead as well. Our greenhouse is constructed using stock panels. And farmers and homesteaders love them because they're easy to put up, they're durable, they're bendable, and they're strong. So let's just go over a few of the variations of stock panels that are available out there. Okay, the first one would be cattle panels. By far, the best containment for mature, hornless, keyword hornless, goats and sheep. They're strong, as I said, they're easy to put up, and they are durable. No matter how much your goats stand on them and walk on them, they'll hold up. Each 16-foot section runs about $20. Now, that works out to $1.25 a foot, plus the cost of the T-post. So while they're wonderful at containing the smaller ruminants, stock panels are not a fence option for pastures or large areas due to the cost. But they work great everywhere else, such as for smaller pens up near the barn. We've even tied two in a circle with zip ties and put it in the garage as temporary birthing pen when one of our goats kitted in frigid weather. They are so versatile. You need to have cattle panels on your farm. You're going to find a use for them, I guarantee it. Okay. Next, we have combo panels. These are just like cattle panels, only there's a tighter spacing or weave, if you will, of the grid at the bottom, and that continues further up than on the regular cattle panels. So the combo panels are good to contain all but the smallest young stock. The denser spacing, however, makes them more expensive, and they usually run in the $40 range. So use those very selectively on your farm. Next, we have hog panels. And as the name suggests, these are really good for pigs. And they're shorter in height because pigs aren't climbers or jumpers. And the spacing of the mesh is closer together at the bottom, so even the smallest piglets would have trouble fitting through. And they're really nice because they're shorter and you can usually step over them to go in and out of a pen. These are great fencing for pigs of all ages, especially if placed on cement or other hard surface that the pigs can't dig under. They're shorter too, they're competitively priced, and they run about $20 each, just like the cattle panels. Now, in the case of putting them on soft dirt, a strand of electrified wire or tape like we used in the picture, about snout high, will usually keep the pigs from trying to root under them and get out. Next, we have sheep and goat panels. Now, I don't think these have been around for a long time. I don't remember them like 10, 15 years ago, but anyway, the grid on these fence sections is tight all the way up, making them just about escape-proof for kids and lambs and impossible for horned goats to put their heads through and get caught. These are also the most expensive variation at, last time I checked online, $57 a piece. But they work nicely for smaller indoor pens and or projects like making hay feeders or slow feeders for horses. There's also a horse version of this fencing, and it's simply taller. Basically the same thing. Okay? Now, big brother to the stock panels are the corral panels.
These are basically metal pipe gates with feet on the bottom that attach to one another for support, making them freestanding. In other words, no posts needed. They are most often used for round pens, which you might have seen in our videos or my videos, arenas, and small holding areas for cattle or temporary stalls for horses, say at an event like a clinic. They come in several different diameters of metal tubes, which determines their strength from light duty up to heavy duty. They come in really handy for constructing pens inside an existing barn, like a pole building if you move onto a farm and there's just a pole building and no interior structures, or for making separations in existing pens and paddocks. They have the advantage of being easy to put up and take down too. And although they're rather expensive, about $70 a piece, they also tend to hold their resale value very well. So if you only need them for a little bit till you get another fencing option put up, you can probably resell them on Craigslist and almost recoup all your money. Okay. Now, most of us raise a variety of animals of various ages through the year. So I want to talk a little bit about multi-species or multi-ages fencing. For example, what if your pasture areas need to confine horses and sheep together, or ewes with lambs, or you're going to be grazing cattle first in a field followed by pigs? In that case, you need to design your fencing to accommodate not only both sides of the animals you're putting together or following each other, but also, perhaps more importantly, their habits. This often leads to combining fence types, such as using a woven wire as a barrier fence but having a strand or two of electric running on the inside, or topping a woven fence with a wooden rail, so like a horse can't lean over it and take it down, or running chicken wire along the bottom of the fencing to keep babies in. It just depends on what you're combining together in the same area as to what's going to work. And sometimes a fence line will be separating two different types of livestock, and what works for one won't work for the other. We have that situation between our horse paddock and the male goat pen. The electrified high tensile fencing towards our neighbor has extra lines added to it to accommodate the goats, but the fence line towards the horse paddock is space for horses. And sometimes one of our boy goats will stick his head through, get zapped on his neck, and come right on through to the horse side. It wouldn't be of a concern because he's still on our property, except I have horses who think they need to chase goats. So to fix the situation, we've decided to put up a dual fence line. The high tensile will stay for the horses, but on the goat side, we'll eventually, because nothing ever happens fast around here, eventually we'll be putting up goat and sheep field fence. You can see the line of metal posts waiting for the woven fence to be attached in these pictures. So that's an option if you have that situation where two different kinds of animals are being kept next to each other and you need fencing for both. Finally, let's not forget what they've done on the British Isles for fencing and property lines for generations, hedgerows. These are especially impressive because they've been used to contain some of the best escape artists on the farm, sheep. While this might be too labor intensive and take too long to be usable for many of you, it might be a fencing method you'll at least want to look into, especially those of you just starting to develop your property and or who have an interest in permaculture. Personally, I know nothing about hedgerows, except I love the look of them, and I really wished I'd investigated their possibility 25 years ago when we first moved in. With the permaculture movement, I think there's a renewed interest in constructing and using hedgerows, so a Google search should yield some really good information for you to get pointed in the right direction, should you want to include them on your farm. Well, that's it, folks. I hope you found this video helpful. Bye-bye.